This is the third session of Sai Pearls of Wisdom. We had two sessions earlier, and during the two sessions earlier we could complete the whole of September conversations of Bhagwan with students and the teachers on the veranda there of Prashanta Nilayam. Now today we'll pass on to the third session, and as we did the first, let's go in the reverse order so that I can keep you updated while covering the earlier portions also. It is on 5th of September. It's on 5th of September. Extremely sorry. 5th of November. I beg your pardon. 5th of November. Yesterday, in the afternoon, Bhagavan was talking about his childhood days. Childhood days. I have not told anybody, because this conversation happened yesterday afternoon. You are first people to hear that. He was speaking of his childhood days and the traditions and the culture of villages in this part of the state. The culture in the village testifies unity among the folks. They all lived in spirit of unity and they cooperated with each other. And particularly during this season, following Deepavali, this month is called Kartika, K-A-R-T-H-I-K-A. This month is called Kartika. During this month, people will have cold water bath in the early hours of the morning, 5 o'clock. And during this month, towards the week ends, people go on a retreat or sadhana camp or spiritual camp. Some kind of fun and frolic. All villagers go to a distant place. They sit there under trees. They dine. They exchange all the food they bring from their homes. They sing. They dance. They play and enjoy. And such festivals bring people together. A sort of understanding. Exchange of views. Promoting fraternity and unity among the inhabitants of the village. Bhagavan was telling, you know, by 5 o'clock morning, we will complete our bath and return during this season. Swami, cold season? Yes, why not? When once you just jump into Chitravati river, you don't feel cold anymore. So long you stand on the sand, you start shivering. When once you jump into the river, no more of cold. Oh, I see, Swami. Nice to hear. I don't venture to do it anyway for myself. And then Bhagavan said, weekends we go to some place and we sit under those trees. And you must have heard of pearl millets. Pearl millets. Millets that look like pearls. There is some preparation made out of pearl millets, and some chili also is mixed. Swami says they are very tasty. I like them even this day. And ragi malt, morsel of ragi malt. Well, I take it. It's very delicious. I like it very much. That's what Bhagavan was telling. And people also dance. They sing. And they also enjoy swing also during this season. Swing. And there's one kind of a dance, what you call kolatam. You know that? There are small sticks of this size. Tuck, tuck. Govinda, Govinda, gaye. Like that. Bhajo Radhe Gopala Krishna gaye. They will hold two sticks and do like that. That's what is called kolatam. And as they do it, in between they jump also, it seems. And Bhagavan said, his grandfather Kondamaraju,
He used to jump in between.
Oh, Swami, very interesting. What did you do then? Did you also do that kolata? Did you also jump along with them? He said, no, I didn't do all that. Then what were you doing, Swami? I collected all urchins, young boys of the village, and started doing bhajans. Panduranga Bhajana Mandali. Panduranga Bhajana Mandali, the first congregation for music, devotional songs, was started by Bhagwan during that time. That's what Bhagwan said. Then Bhagwan also recalled yesterday, it seems there were untouchables in those days. Untouchables. People lived in the outskirts of the village. Today it's not like that. Today they are privileged class. But in those days, they lived in the outskirts of the village. Swami, it seems, once promised that he would visit one of them. That gentleman's name happens to be Madiga Narayana. He said, I would come to your house. And Swami went. And Swami was followed by Karanam Subbamma. Karanam Subbamma is a Brahmin. Brahmins don't visit untouchables even in their dreams in those days. If they see them face to face, they will have bath immediately. That was the situation in those days. But this lady followed Bhagavan. And Swami said, don't do that. All villagers will feel so bad. For me, all are one. I'll go to anybody. But it's not proper on your part. Then she says, Swami, I don't care for this society. I am not bothered what others think of me. I want you. Wherever you go, I follow you. That's what she said. That's what Bhagwan said. He also recalled that the villagers, they never locked their houses. No locks. No lock and key system. Just doors open. That's all. No thefts. No thieves in those days. And all people go to the outskirts of the village, celebrate all festival during this season. They sit under trees and have all the fun there. And nothing happens in the village during that time. That was the level of honesty and integrity in villages in those days, as Bhagwan said. And after playing the whole day with all games, what do? They just lie down on the sands and they enjoy beautiful sleep without you foam bed, my foam bed, cushions, anything. They just lie down on the sands. They sleep well. That's what Bhagwan said on those days. And then he also said another point. It seems his mother, Ishwaramma, the two sisters, Venkamma and Parvatamma, all the three are experts in swimming. Swimming. They taught swimming to the children of the village in those days. It seems they would carry small children and help them to swim. Initially, and then later, just leave them alone. They learned the art of swimming themselves. That's what Bhagwan said yesterday. This is the latest thing with which we want to start. Then I come to the 1st of November. The 1st of November and also on the 28th of October, these two days are important in the sense Swami spoke to a gentleman from Greece. The gentleman's name is George. And Swami stood there and just called, "Hey Greece, come here." The gentleman was crawling on his feet, crawling. And I was wondering, something wrong with his feet or something like that. Swami said, "See how he is coming." Swami is crawling on the feet out of devotion. They are not like you to walk like rowdies. No. See his devotion. Oh, I see, Swami. And he came there. And then Swami asked him, "Boy, what's your name?" "George, Swami." "Oh, George. What do you do there?" "Swami, I run a bookstall." "What is the name of the bookstores?" "Ananda, Swami. Ananda." "Oh. Who else assist you? Swami, my sister helps me. Oh, I see. What do? Swami, bookstores. Cleaning, selling, all that. Oh, then what else? We sing, Swami. What do you sing? Sai bhajans. Where do you sing? Throughout the day. Where do you sing? Everywhere. Swami starts, see his devotion. You are not like that. Fellow from Greece, see their devotion. He went on telling. And then he said, oh, I see. Last time, how did you come to Prashantinilayam? How did you reach here? Swami, I came by walk from Bangalore airport to Puttaparthi. Oh, how many miles? 180 miles, Swami. How long did it take? 4 days, Swami. Oh, did you just walk like that? No, Swami. 18 kgs of luggage on the back. He walked for 4 days to reach Prashantinilayam. Swami said, any one of you like that? See his devotion, he was telling. Then Swami said, since how long have you been coming to Puttaparthi? Swami, 29 years. I have been visiting this place since 29 years. What did you do in those days? Swami, I used to collect sand from Prashantinilayam, put it in a bag. Wherever you walked, I collected the sand, collected in bags, and took it back to Greece and kept it there in my puja room at the altar. I said, Hare Sira boys, you see Swami every day. See that Greece man? And then he was teasing them like that. And then Swami said, you see, marriage, are you married? No, Swami, no. For some help for cooking. Why don't you marry? No, Swami, I don't want to marry. Why? No, Swami. He went on crying. Then Swami looked at me and said, why does he cry? I said, Swami, those who got married all cry. And I am happy the fellow who is not married is also crying. So both of us cry, no difference. What is that? So because of the fear of the marriage, he is crying. Because we got married, we are crying. All right, let us cry in chorus. That's what I said. He said, Swami, no marriage. And then Swami said, hey, you are only fellow who came here? No, Swami. My friend also sitting there. Your friend? Yes. Who is he? Swami is international Olympic champion. Olympic champ? Yes. High jump, number one in the world from Greece. He is also here, Swami. Oh, I see. Come on, boy, he called him. That fellow came. Very tall, I say. Tuck, 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 he came there. What? Tell your experience to these boys. He went on telling. He got married and his wife was in the family way and they were expecting the child. At that moment, this girl, his wife, consulted many doctors and they all said the girl would deliver male child. All tests, scanning tests, all tests confirmed that male child would be born to his wife. But both of them prayed to Swami, Swami, we want a baby girl, not a boy. Swami said, all doctors said you will have male child. No, Swami, you can do it. Do you have faith? Yes, you go. They went and that girl delivered female child as they wanted. And Swami said, Taka, I changed, Ra. I changed. If you don't behave properly, you boys, I'll change you into girls immediately. Behave yourself properly. That's what. And then Swami said, see, I judge. All your relations are there in Greece. Why do you come here when all your relatives are there in Greece? No, Swami, I have no relations. You have no relatives? No. Are? It's strange. Don't you have relations? Swami again asked. Swami, Sai devotees are my relatives. Sai devotees are my relations. I don't have anybody else. Bhagavan was happy. George, are you going to stay here for birthday? No, Swami, I must go back. You must go back. Why? We celebrate your birthday there in Greece. I see. How do you celebrate? How? Swami, balloons, lights, illumination, balloons, sweets distribution. Oh, I see. How many devotees are there in Greece? Swami, ministers, officers, educated, many people are your devotees. Oh, good, good. All right. You go to Greece and celebrate Baba's birthday. Swami went inside, gave him a pair of new clothes as his birthday's gift. That's what had happened on the 1st of November and 28th of October. And on the same day, 28th of October, all boys were expected to report because the college started on 29th. They should report by 28th itself. So Swami called the warden of the Bangalore campus. Hey warden, have all boys come? Have all boys reported to you? Yes, Swami, all came. All 300. Hey, why do you bluff like that? Three boys have not come, I know. Why do you bluff like that? Then warden started shivering. Sorry, Swami, sorry. Three have not come. Why? Before the warden answered, Swami said, one boy had a fracture, so he didn't come. Another boy is suffering from jaundice, so he did not come. And another boy, he got stuck up on the way because buses and trains are cancelled due to strike there in Karnataka because there is some water dispute. All transport was suspended at that time, so boy could not reach. You said all have come. No. Three have not come. We were all really wonderstruck when Bhagavan said that. And then I pass on to the 4th of November, what Bhagavan said. 4th of November, what did he say? He said as if he was helpless. What did he say? My actions, my words are not understood by many people. You don't understand my actions. You don't know the meaning of what I say. Some people are even mistaken. They feel so bad because I use some words that make them feel hurt. They don't understand. That makes me very much worried. I don't tell you the meaning of my actions. I'll never explain the inner significance of my actions. I feel so bad because you don't understand the spirit behind it. Whatever I say, whatever I do, are in your own interest. I am not selfish. What made Swami say that statement when I was there? Then I started introspecting. On 4th, Swami was very harsh to me. Abba blasted me like anything. I felt so bad. Very much hurt. And in the afternoon he says, some people don't understand my words. Some people don't understand my actions. They don't know whatever I say is in your own. It only, not some people, it meant only me. Nobody else. Oh, Swami can directly tell me why this indirect way. So that's what I felt. And this happened on the 3rd of November. The 3rd of November. What did he say? Bhagavan just came out and stood there in front of us and said, look here, Anil Kumar, you know what happened yesterday there in our hospital? Swami, what happened? 11-year boy was operated for his heart problem. Operation was successful, but later some complications started. The abdomen has swollen and he could not ease himself. Terrific pain in the abdomen and complications. Doctors were very much worried. They came to Swami. Operation was successful, but later complications. What shall we do? Bhagavan materialized vibhuti for that boy. The doctors applied vibhuti there. Everything normal. That night itself we had normal dinner. That's what Swami said. In this context, I want to bring to your attention a very important point. Dr. Alreza, the superintendent of General Hospital, goes to Swami every day. Swami, so and so is to be operated, so and so is to be treated, so and so is to be admitted. We want prasadam. Swami gives prasadam to everybody and sometimes tells, don't operate, give this medicine, treat this, it is not influenza, it is pneumonia. He goes on telling them. I am the witness to the such things. Bhagwan Baba, the doctor of doctors, not only diagnoses the disease but gives prescription too. That's what had happened on the 3rd of November. And then I should also let you know what Bhagwan said on 29th of October. 29th of October. It was the time when all boys sat in the front row. A very pleasant evening. Weather is fine. Very cool. Bhagwan said, the weather and the climate is like Kodaikanal. You'll be enjoying the whole Puttaparthi, Prashantralayam is air conditioned. Air conditioned. And then some boy said, Swami, we want to recite Vedam. Vedam. Baba said, wait. Then I said, Swami, Veda chanting is auspicious. If they chant Veda, it will be auspicious to everybody. All devotees will be very happy to hear the Veda chanting. Please permit. Come on, this man is recommending. All right, you do it. And they started Veda chanting, reciting Veda. Then at the end of that line of boys, I saw young children, kids. They too started chanting Veda. I saw their lip movement. Then I said, Swami, I see children also joining Veda. What? Children know much better than the big boys. He asked these boys, stop. And he called those children, come, sit, come and chant Veda. They started chanting Veda better than the big boys. I tell you. Then Swami looked at him, see, can you do like that? Can you recite Veda? What shall I say? Swami, I was not the student of your institution. How do you expect me to chant Veda? No. So for the simple reason that they studied here, they have learnt. For the same reason I have not studied here, so I don't know Veda chanting. Oh, manchi nak cheppam. Instead of telling I don't know, you are telling that you are not the student of the school. Good. All our boys and girls, all children, grown up boys, PhD students of all the three campuses, Vrindavan, Prashant, Anantapuram, they all know Veda. They know how to chant Veda. Then I said, Swami, your institutions are the very symbols of Vedic culture, ancient tradition, the very metaphor of Veda. So I am not surprised. That's what had happened on the 29th. In the same context, Baba said, in Veda chanting, there are two portions. I refer to Veda chanting of that day, that is 29th of October. There are two portions. One portion is Namakam, N-A-M-A-K-A-M. The second part is Chamakam, C-H-A-M-A-K-A-M. Namakam, Chamakam are the two parts in Veda chanting of that day. Swami started explaining. Namakam, the first part says, I don't want anything. Na, ma. Na, no. Ma, wants. I don't want anything. I don't want anything is the first half. By the second half, chamakam, I want, full of desires. What do they desire? Oh God, grant us pure air, grant us good drinking water, bless us with good food. That is chamakam, prayers of request. Well, you must have understood by now that I am an extrovert. I cannot keep anything to myself. I will immediately ask and take the divine risks and face spiritual dangers and threats. But I can't help it. I am born with this openness. What to do? Then I said, Swami, while we say I don't want anything, namakam, why should I say I want everything, chamakam? Why both the types of prayers? Either you should pray, I want it, or say, I don't want it. What is the fun of saying both? Then Baba immediately said, both are there in Veda, so that those people that have desires will recite chamakam. Those people who have no desires, they will recite namakam, that's all. Veda gives provision for both the types of people, for both the categories of people. That's what Bhagavan said. Further, Bhagavan also said, look here, those sages, ancient sages, they did penance for a long time and they said, Vedaha Vedam, Vedaha Metam, Purusham Mahantam, Aditya Varnam, Stamasah Parastat. It is a quotation from Veda. The sages said, Vedaha Metam, Purusham Mahantam. We have seen God. Saints said, we have seen God. Purusham Mahantam. Purusha is God. We have seen that Purusha. Vedahametam Purusham Mahantam. We have seen God. Where? Stamasah Parastat. Stamasah Parastat. Beyond darkness. Beyond darkness, we have seen God. Meaning, darkness of ignorance, beyond the darkness of ignorance, there is effulgence or the light of the divinity. See what a thing it is. Then Bhagavan said, and saints declared that God is everywhere, inside and also outside. Antar bahischa tat sarvam. Antar, inside. Bahischa, outside. Tat sarvam. Divinity is present everywhere. Vyapya, he spread. Narayana sthitaha. God has installed everywhere, inside and outside. That's what Bhagavan said, explaining Veda that day. Then I pass on to the 22nd of October. That evening Swami asked one boy to speak. That boy did his MSc in bioscience. He did his MBA, an outstanding student. Now as serving as technical officer in the super specialty hospital. Swami asked him to speak. He said two miracles which are very interesting. It seems a father came with his daughter, young daughter, and doctors examined her and said she should be operated upon because of the heart problem. But doctors said, even after operation, you need to spend 200 rupees per month because the girl has to take medicine for 2 years. We'll operate her now. Later, every month she has to spend 200 rupees per month towards expenses to buy medicines. The father said, we can't afford 200 rupees. Doctor sir, I have a boy. I have to take care of my son. If I spend 200 rupees per month on this little girl, what will happen to him? Moreover, my son will be able to earn money, whereas this girl will not be able to earn money, small girl. So why waste of money? The father said. The same matter was reported to Bhagavan. Swami, the father said that he cannot afford 200 rupees per month. That too is a waste of money to spend on the little girl when he has got a boy whom he has to maintain, take care of, and who would also earn later. Swami melted. Swami was deeply touched. Immediately told doctors, treat her immediately. Send 200 rupees every month to that girl for 2 years to come. Not only this girl, any patient who cannot afford money, tell them that we'll send money from here for their maintenance. I don't think that there is any hospital like this in this world. Free operation, free treatment, free medicines, diet free, and also maintenance medicines for 2 years. Who will do that? And he also made a mention of another miracle. You know, there in the border near Pakistan, one fellow came all the way and he had some heart problem. There in the border, Pakistan border, somebody told him, go to Puttaparthi and everything is free there. Surgery, treatment, everything, don't worry. And somebody told him there in Ladakh, that border area, don't worry, you are going to God. He will never send you empty-handed. You will return positively, hale and healthy, don't worry. That man came here, got himself operated and returned. As a token of love, he wrote a letter to Swami, how to pay the debt of gratitude. How to express thanks to you, Swami, because you saved my life. That's what he said on the 22nd of October. Then I pass on to the 21st of October. What Bhagwan has said on the 21st of October. See, I made all this homework so that there won't be any confusion, you know. Yes. Bhagavan asked two boys to speak on that day, 21st of October. One boy by name Sri Ram Parashuram, who was sent to California for his studies on hospital management, Loma Linda University. And that boy did his MSc in chemistry and a gold medalist, a smart guy indeed. And he said this point, coal, peace is transformed into a diamond, by the touch of Bhagavan. We students are like pieces, coal pieces, charcoal, useless stuff. But in the hands of Bhagavan, we have been transformed into priceless, most precious diamonds, thanks to Swami. That's what he said. Then he made a mention of another point. Look here, all school children speak fearlessly. You must be watching. Someday, Sundays, when Swami asks them to speak, they all make a beeline, one after one. They have no fear. They are ready to speak. If Swami asks any big boy, Swami, he has got some reservation. He is not ready to speak. But children are ever ready. This boy spoke on this theme. He said, primary school children are ready to get up any time. They are ready to speak any time. Why? Children are innocent. Innocence is divine. Innocence is godly. Innocence is child behavior. And because of their innocence, they have total love for Bhagavan. And due to love, they are 100% successful in their performance. A very good development. First, innocence. Innocence leads, takes you to love, and love leads to victory. That's the case with children. Then he said, but with boys, grown-up boys of the college, what happens? Ego. Ego. Whether I am going to speak well or not. How many claps am I going to get? How many people are going to congratulate me? Will Swami be happy or not? People should speak of me as a good speaker. So this is ego. With age, we develop ego. And this ego leads to sense of fear. Fear. Fear is due to ego. And this fear is responsible for failure. Fear is the cause for failure. That is the case with grown-up boys. That's what Sri Ram Parishuram said. Then I'll make a mention of one or two points mentioned by other speaker by name Arun Kumar. Arun Kumar did his engineering from a prestigious institute, Indian Institute of Technology, and later he did his MBA, and now working in Sai Radio for Global Harmony. That boy mentioned two points. One experience. What is it? That boy said this. It seems the train was moving fast, and one drunkard, awfully drunk, got into the compartment and was standing there and almost lost his awareness and started misbehaving, started talking as he liked, all abusive vulgar language. One girl was sitting just opposite. She was feeling so sad, Swami, save me. This drunkard may sit here because there is some place. And if this drunkard sits here by my side, how to bear his company? Awful smelling, idiotic behavior. What to do? She is praying. And another fellow passenger said in the train, hey, sit down there, there is space. You sit down, he said. Where is the space? By the side of this girl who was already praying, let not that fellow sit here. That drunkard came close. When he is about to sit, he shouted, why do you ask me to sit there? There is already a man seated there. Don't you see him? A short man with red robes, long hair, is already seated there. Don't you see? He said, nobody is seated there. Go say, no, you are a blind fellow. He is already seated there. That's how Swami rescued and saved that girl from embarrassment. And then Arun Kumar made a mention of another thing. We people feel happy with the world. In fact, happiness is not there in the world. Happiness is there within, not outside. Happiness is not outside. Happiness is within. Why? You are the embodiment of bliss. You are the embodiment of truth. You are the embodiment of peace. You are the bliss. To think that bliss is outside is a mistaken idea. The bliss is in you. You are the bliss. Then in this context, he gave one example. It seems a street dog caught hold of a bone. This dog went on biting that bone. in the process bleeding started and some blood came out and it was spread on the surface of the bone. The dog started licking the blood, enjoying it. The dog thinks that blood is outside, which it relishes. But actually, blood does not come from anywhere. It is its own blood. That's all. Similarly, we are happy with some people. We are happy with some objects. Not because of happiness out of them. Not because of happiness outside. It is only your own reaction, reflection and resound. That's what that boy mentioned on the day, which I liked very much, that I wanted to share them with you. Now I come to the 19th of October. Just a minute. Yes. 19th of October. Bhagavan just was talking to professors there. As you know, usually boys will put up a drama on 22nd of November, the day of convocation of Satya University. Every year they stage a drama. Swami, on 19th of October, in a most casual manner, he asked, what drama you are getting ready? Somebody said, Swami, different religions. I see. He asked another boy, what drama are you reading? Swami, there is lot of violence outside. And we show what love is, what unity is. Swami said, look here, I don't want you to criticize any religion. I don't want you to criticize any other country. I don't want you to expose the differences. I don't want you to project anything that is a negative. Never project negative things to the public. No. Focus positive things in you. I always say that there is only one caste, the caste of humanity. There is only one religion, the religion of love. I want you to develop theme along these lines. Not religions, not clashes, not differences of opinion, not violence. I don't want it. That's what Bhagavan said. And finally he said, in these institutions, you must have understood by now that the purpose of such an education institution is, the objective of such a Sai educational philosophy is that love is God, God is love, live with love. All students should know that God is love and love is God, and you have to live in love. There is no other theme for our institutions. So I want our boys to project this love in their drama. That should be the theme. No fighting, no arguments. That's what he has said. Then, 18th of October, what did Bhagavan say on 18th of October? Well, by the slip of the tongue, I said, Swami, there is some violence somewhere. The newspaper reported this morning, so many are killed there. Then he said, you are always after some news. What is there in the news except a nuisance? News is nothing but nuisance. Oh, I see. You are speaking about violence outside? Then Bhagavan said, nothing great in killing people. Nothing great in killing people. Cobra can kill people. Lion can kill people. Tiger can kill people. Scorpion can kill people. So, nothing great in killing people. Greatness lies in helping people. Greatness lies in serving people. Greatness lies in making others happy. Nothing great in killing others. That's what Bhagavan said on 18th. And further, he also made another statement. It is this story, I don't know how far you would follow that. Of course, to say that it's also too much, because I know many of the foreigners who know more stories than what we know. And I also met some of the foreigners who have gone through Bhagavad Gita, Tripura Rahasya in depth. Most of us do not know those things. I am sorry to say that. The Sai family is such today, distance is not the criterion. Distance does not matter. I met some of the devotees from Argentina. They have gone through all these texts. Well, I saw one gentleman from Argentina reading Tripura Rahasyam. I never read it. I asked him, what is this? He said, don't you know this? He said, well, I'm sorry. I'll know and then meet you later. So, I shouldn't doubt your scholarship. This is an illustration from Mahabharata. Mahabharata. This is an instance where the birth of Karna, the birth of Karna was not conveyed to the world, because Virgin Kunti gave birth to Karna before she got married. So it's a matter of insult. It's a matter of prestige of the family. So she didn't tell anybody about the birth of this boy, gifted to her by Sun God himself. Somehow she left that baby, and that baby was taken care of by person, a low caste man, and he was brought up by him. But towards the end of the war, towards that war time, Pandavas were ready to kill anybody. This boy was brought up, was the chieftain of the opposite camp. He was the major general of the opposite camp. Naturally, mother is a mother. She goes to that man and tells him, look here, you are my eldest son. The other five are your younger brothers. You belong to that enemy's camp. I want you to give me a boon as your mother. Don't kill your brothers like that. Don't kill your brothers. You may be the chief of the enemy's camp. She went on crying. Then this Karna said, mother, what a thing you have done. Why did you not tell them that I am their brother? Why did you not tell me earlier that I am your son? What a tragedy is going to take place now. That boy also cried. And then, look here, mother, I am the chief of that enemy's camp, Kauravas, but I should be loyal to my king. Because in the last moment you tell me I am your son, I am not going to leave this. I should be loyal to the king. So, I don't touch four of your sons, but I'll attack only one man, Arjuna. He is my enemy, I'll kill him, that's all. Other four, I don't touch them. Don't be worried, that's what he said. Bhagavan was explaining this. Then immediately I said, Swami, is it not wrong on the part of Kunti for not telling the truth that Karna was her son, eldest son? Is it proper on her part to hide like that? Bhagavan is really supreme. He will never humiliate any character. He will make every character sublime. He said, no, you are mistaken. Kunti is not wrong. She did not reveal that Karna is her son. Why? because it is the prestige of the family. He was born to her when she was not married. If this truth was revealed to everybody, the royal family will be viewed very cheap by the kingdom. So, for the prestige of the family, she did not reveal the truth. That's how he built up the nobility of the character. And then he says, in those days, the punishment was not capital punishment. One need not be beheaded and killed. It is enough if he is given a total shave, completely shaven head, drive him out of the country. Don't step into this country. That is the capital punishment. He doesn't have to be killed with a sword. No. Let him go. Leave this country with a shaven head. Extermination. That is what it is. A capital punishment in those days. That's what Bhagavan has said. Later, he made reference to two people from Mahabharata. One is Bhishmacharya, another is Dronacharya. Acharya means professor. Bhishmacharya is a real professor, Acharya, because he practiced what all he taught. He practiced what all he preached. Whereas other man, Dronacharya, that professor is only a title. It is only a title because he did not practice what he preached. This is a revelation for the first time. And then he made a reference to Ramayana on the same day, 18th. There is one person by name Parashurama, who killed all Kshatriyas because he has taken a vow that all Kshatriyas should be killed. He went on killing everybody, but the lives of two Kshatriyas are saved. One is Dasharatha, other is Janaka. Dasharatha is the father of Rama. Janaka is the father of Sita. These two are saved. How? Swami, when everybody are killed, how is it these two people could be saved? Then Swami gave the answer. A newly married man should not be killed. Dasharatha had three wives and he married one after one. Whenever person was ready to kill him, he was just then married. So he got his life saved like that. And then how about Janaka, the other king, the father of Sita? He is also, his life is also saved. How? The one who is performing yajna should not be killed. So he was performing yajna, so he was spared. Dasharatha and Janaka were spared like that, and they happened to be the parents of Rama and Sita. That is all the divine drama. That's what Bhagavan said. I should also let you know what had happened. Is the time up? Is the time up? Yes. On the 16th of October, what Swami said, few questions have been put to him. One question: Swami, for every action there is a reaction. For every action there is a result. Karma, action, karma phala, the result of the action. So whatever I do, I cannot escape from the consequences of my actions. If my actions are good, I'll have good results. If my actions are bad, there'll be bad results. I have to face them. I cannot run away from the consequence. This is what you say. But I have one doubt, Swami. What is it? In Advaita, in non-dualistic philosophy, in non-dualistic philosophy, there is neither action nor the doer, anything like that. There is no action, there is no doer, because all the life is a dream as per non-dualistic philosophy. Swami, how to explain this action reaction on one hand, and that you are not the doer and there is no action whatsoever? How to correlate this non-dualistic philosophy and Shankara Advaita and this action reaction? Then Bhagavan immediately said, go to the root cause of action. What is the cause of your action? Thought. Where from has it arisen? From the mind. So mind, out of the mind, thought has arisen. Thought has led to action. Action has given you the consequence or rewards or results. Now, so long you operate at the level of the mind, so long you work at the level of the mind, you cannot be free from karma phala or consequences of your actions. You cannot escape from the reaction because you are operating at the level of the mind. But Shankara Advaita says that you should transcend the mind. You should go beyond the mind. Oh Swami, transcend the mind? Beyond the mind? Is it possible? What is all about? Please let me know. Baba said, to transcend the mind, to go beyond the mind, know the mind what it is. Oh, I only say never mind, but I don't know what mind is. Swami, what is mind? Look here. Mind is nothing but bundle of thoughts, like threads interwoven make a piece of cloth. Bundle of thoughts interwoven constitute the mind. So Swami, how to go beyond the mind? Withdraw all the thoughts. You be thoughtless. When you are thoughtless, there is no mind. When there are no threads, when there is no yarn, there is no cloth. Similarly, when there are no thoughts, there is no mind. Oh ho. Swami, how to be thoughtless? How to be thoughtless? Yes, it is possible. Why? How? By diverting the mind towards God. Divert. Direct your mind towards the God. Your mind is towards the world. Now divert it. Direct it. Redirect it towards God. Then once the mind is directed towards God, thoughts disappear. The mind is full of divinity. The mind is full of God. No more of thoughts. No more of the mind. No more of action. No more of reactions. That is the way he said. So nice to hear, which I am yet to practice. Then, Swami, how to develop positive thinking? It is very easy, he said. Very easy. When a fellow starts blaming me, how can I take it positively? When a fellow is harming me, how can I have positive thinking towards him? When fellow is doing so much of a harm, how can I have positive thinking? Is that possible? Very easy. Swami, how? Please let me know. When once you think, all that is said to you, all that is done against you, is for your own good, that is positive thinking. Positive thinking is this, which meant taking everything for your own good. No matter whatever others comment about you, no matter whatever others may do towards you, no matter whatever harm is caused or done to you, just if you take it for my own good, well, that is positive thinking. I see. Any more, Swami? Positive thinking, how to develop that? How to think that is everything is for my good? I beat you, can you take it for your good? How is it? Then he said, it is possible by having strong faith in God. Strong faith in God, that helps you to develop positive thinking. Somebody asked, Swami, what is the difference between the individual mind and the cosmic mind? What is the difference between individual mind and cosmic mind? Swami said, cosmic mind is universal. Cosmic mind is divinity. The individual mind is an entity. Individual mind is an entity. It is an identity. Entity and identity with a name and form. Where the cosmic mind, our universal mind, is nameless and formless, universal. Nameless, formless, universal mind is cosmic mind. The one with a name and form, entity and identity, is the individual mind. Oh Swami, is there any relationship between the two? Yes, both are same. Both are same. This has a form that has no form. This has a name that has no name. This is after all an entity that is universal and cosmic. How can they be one? Very simple. How Bhagavan? How is this? Yes, it is very simple. Why? And how? When once the individual forgets his identity, when once he is not mindful of the name and form, then once he transcends, goes beyond the name and the form, when once he is not attached to name and form any longer, he becomes the cosmic mind. So long you are attached to your name and form, you are different from the cosmic mind. Then once the name and form are just given up, the individual mind and the cosmic mind are one and the same. Still I don't understand, Swami. Still I don't understand. Swami said, very simple. Here is a balloon full of air inside. There is air all around. The air all around is the cosmic mind. The air inside the balloon is the individual mind. When once the balloon bursts, the air in the balloon merges into the air around. There is no difference. So difference is due to size, name and form of the balloon. There is no difference between the air of the balloon and the air around the balloon. So the individual mind and cosmic mind, they are different because of the name and the form. That's what Bhagavan said. Swami, permit us to put another question. What is it? Swami, what is the purpose of life? Simple question. What is the purpose of life? Swami said, the purpose of life is to find unity with God. To realize divinity within, to find unity with God, to know that you are God. That's all. That is the purpose of life. So long you feel that you are different from God, well, you are still, there's a long way to go. You are still to travel, still to continue along the spiritual path, until that identity, that oneness, that unity is realized and experienced. That's what Bhagavan said on that day. The 16th of October, that's what he has said. And then, I would like to talk to you what happened on 9th of October. Yes. 9th of October, yes. What did he say? It was the day when Swami ordered for the distribution of ice creams to all students. Wow, ice cream is very nice, you know. We all like it. And they were distributing cups to everybody. Swami suddenly came, called these boys. Hey boys, have you distributed ice creams to everybody? Yes, Swami. All got it? Yes. Are a useless fellow. Those two boys did not get. Go and give them. And then he turned to everybody and said, you call yourself brothers and brothers on the dais. Look here. Brothers will forget. Mother will not forget. Brothers may forget. Mother will not forget. This is an indication that Bhagavan is a mother. And then I should also tell you another instance that was told on 9th of October. What is it? Bhagavan takes upon himself the sickness of others. The sickness of others. What will happen? Will he suffer? Why should he accept sickness? Swami said this. I accept, I receive, I suffer on your behalf in response to your prayers. Because left to you, this pain is unbearable. The pain is unbearable. The pain is excruciating. Pain is terrible. You cannot bear it. As you pray, I take it upon myself. Swami, you also suffer as I suffer. Will you have pain as I have? Yes. But the duration is for short time in my case. When you are to suffer for a long time, when I take it upon myself, the period of suffering is cut short to a very brief time, so that you are free from that sickness. You are free from that pain. That's why I accept others' pain. That's what Bhagavan has said. In this instance, Swami granted an interview to a schoolboy who was asthmatic. Asthma people find it tough during this season, rainy season, very difficult to breathe. That young boy came, innocent, Swami, I cannot suffer, unbearable, Swami. Oh, I see. Don't worry, my child, don't worry. Immediately Swami was gasping, because he has taken upon himself that asthma problem. It lasted for a couple of minutes. Later it subsided. Swami was normal and said, you won't have asthmatic attack again. Don't worry, he said. This is an instance to say how Baba takes it upon himself, the suffering of the people, and gives them total relief. Before I conclude, one incident that what he said yesterday, Bhagavan came out and said, have you seen the doctor? Swami, I have not seen. Because the doctor went into the interview room and came out. I sit there on the steps, as you know. How can I see him? Impossible. Swami, I did not see him. Baba said, the doctor is from Germany. And he and his wife, both of them are heart specialists. Top doctors from Germany. And they did several of the heart transplantations. Heart transplant. And the heart transplant experts, and now they are invited by the government of Australia to go and serve there. Before they leave that place, go to Australia, they wanted to have darshan of Baba and go there. They heard of Baba. They heard of work done in super specialty hospital. They, having heard about Swami, they wanted to come here, study, and then go to Australia with his inspiration and the divine blessings. May Bhagavan bless you. Sai Ram. जय जय प्रभु गिरिधारी नटवर नंदलाला जय नटवर नंदलाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला नटवर नटवर नंदलाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला नटवर हे गिरिधर गोपाला 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 जय जय प्रभु गिरिधारी नटवर नंदलाला नटवर नंदला नटवर नंदलाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे गिरिधर गोपाला हे जय जय प्रभु गिरिधर नटवर नंदलाल ओ असतो मा सगमज तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय ओ लोकास्समस्ताः सुखिनो भवन्तु लोकास्समस्ताः सुखिनो भवन्तु लोकास्समस्ताः सुखिनो भवन्तु ॐ शान्ति 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 जय बोलो भगवान श्री सच्च साई बाबा जी की।